October. Do you know what that means? Pardon?
Colors.
Colors. It does mean colors. In our family, it means birthdays. And even more importantly, it means baseball. You see, if you've grown up like I have, a Cubs fan, you know better than to pay attention to the regular season because, well, it's just painful. Except for last year. For years and years and years and years and years, we spent time suffering. We get to October and so close, just so close, only to have our hopes dashed against the rocks yet again. And then last year, I don't know about the rest of you, but I still get cross-eyed when I see people wearing shirts that say World Championship Chicago Cup. What? Not that I don't rejoice in it, but it's just, it seems so strange. If it happens again, I don't promise that I'll be in church the next day. Because you don't understand. 100 and almost 10 years is a really long time to wait. Here's the thing, though. Here's what I learned from being a Cubs fan. When everything falls apart, you still have your Cubbies. You still have Wrigley Field. You still can walk anywhere in the country and recognize that red seed on someone else's hat. Know that they have suffered along with you. And there's great joy in finding them. I have a knack for finding teams that tend to lose. I mean, I went to the University of Illinois, where they show up on the football field but don't really remember how to play. The Cubs always get so close, and then somebody drops a ball, or someone else catches it who's not supposed to. You see where I'm going with all this? So you can imagine the great rejoicing last year on October 15th, where I think I wore a hole in the wooden floor. That wasn't supposed to happen. But what I knew is that I belonged to that group, that tribe. My whole life, I belonged to that group. And we were connected by that great vine called WGN. See where I'm going with this? This great vine that connected all of us, all over the country, back to the source, right here. So matter the suffering that we went through, get to it, we had this great joy of knowing that we could still go find our homes at WGN or in Wrigley Field. Today we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, joy. And I don't see how you can talk about joy without talking about suffering. I make light of that example. But for some people, it's very real. For all of us who are multi-generational Cubs fans, we understand this. We understand that life is suffering in many ways. And that we are not guaranteed to be winners in the end. The joy is knowing we belong to something bigger. So here we go as Christians. Our faith does not guarantee that we will not suffer in this life. But what it gives us is connection to know that the presence of God is always with us. Always. When we walk through life, we carry with us know this because he sent his son. And we know that God has suffered like we do, and that on the other side of that is great joy. Webster's Dictionary describes joy as great happiness. I think that lessens what joy is. Because joy is not linked to a moment in time or an acquisition of something, but it's pervasive in our lives. It's always there. Sometimes it's harder to find, but it's always there. Kay Warren of Saddleback Church writes this, that joy is knowing that God is in control of every detail of my life and choosing to rejoice in his presence. Finding that joy is a choice that we make. It's not an accident. We don't stumble upon it. Being open to the presence of God is a choice. Regardless of anything else that's going on around us. But when we make that choice, it's amazing how that pervades everything else in our lives. We then begin to recognize God in every moment. And we chuckle because, as Episcopalians, we don't have this ongoing out loud conversation with God. But if you listen to people who have made that choice, you can hear them say things like, thank you, Jesus, for this morning. Heavenly Father, give me strength to go through this day and make one more day. That's where I learned about making the choice to have God in his presence. Always in my life. I listened to the housekeepers in the first hotel I went to, who had actively made that choice, and so every moment of their life, Jesus, please give me strength not to hurt this one more person. Or Jesus, thank you for the fact that I have a job. Jesus, thank you for letting me be a witness to the world around me. Thank you for the joy of carrying your light into the world. Every second of their day, they had these ongoing conversations. They knew they were connected to that body that we heard about in the gospel. What the tenants forgot was that they couldn't be connected to that vine without the landlord. But these women that I essentially grew up next to, because I was 21 when I had my first job, these women reminded me that you can never forget that you belong to the landlord. And that you belong to the vine. And that's where we get our strength from. And their lives were as chaotic, if not more chaotic, than our lives are when they walked out of those hotels or out of their churches. And yet they knew that they had the presence of God with them. Yes, just like that, every day here. Every time you walk out of these doors, I want you to remember that you choose to carry the joy that God's, what God's given to you. And people will see it. You don't have to hear it from you. They will see it. God is present with you, always. No matter how long suffering we are, whether we're the tribes of Israel or just regular old Chicago fans, at some point we have a cause for great rejoicing. This evening when you go to bed, Make the choice to set aside your burdens. And remember that always joy comes in love.